Meeting to order, roll call, please.
Gonzalez.
Here.
Caldwell.
Here.
Meininger.
Here.
Shaver.
Here.
McCarthy.
Ask you to stand for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
For public information, a copy of the Nebraska Open Meeting Act is available for your review on the back wall underneath the clock. Is there any changes in the agenda?
We do have one change, Your Honor. We need to remove item number, is it quite prepared? Item number 10D.
10.
D as in dog.
D as in dog. And make a motion to remove 10D as in dog.
Second.
Call the roll.
Gonzalez.
Yes.
Caldwell.
Yes.
Meininger.
Yes.
Shaver.
Yes.
Okay, citizen with business not scheduled on the agenda as required by state law, no matter may be considered under this item unless council determines that the matter requires emergency action. Is there anybody in the audience tonight that may have something to address under emergency action? If not, I'd like to welcome you to the special city council meeting. If you have anything to address the council tonight, I ask you that you come forward. We'll give you some time to sign in on the register. I ask you that you state your name, who you are representing. I ask you to speak into the microphone. This is recorded and played back on LA Communications. In case of emergency tonight, do you have exit doors right behind the door that you came through? Also down the hallway to the left or the right, there's exits. In the case of a tornado tonight, there's the fallout shelter would be down here by the hallway by the bathrooms.
I understand if we wish to address the council at some point this evening, we should come forward then.
No, you need to come forward at that time and then sign in on the register. Mm-hmm. Okay, item number 6, consent calendar. Make a motion to approve.
Second.
Okay, I got Scott second in. Call the roll.
Caldwell.
Yes.
Meininger.
Yes.
Shaver.
Yes.
Gonzalez.
Yes.
7A, regular claims.
Approval.
Second.
Call the roll.
Meininger.
Yes.
Shaver.
Yes.
Gonzalez.
Yes.
Caldwell.
Yes.
Okay, it's not time for the public hearing yet, so we're going to go to 9A. Council received a presentation from the Sheriff's House on the implementation of Nebraska's Youth System and Care Initiative.
Hi.
update or?
We are already in effect. We've already, we're implementing as we speak. So what we're doing right now is just how we roll out our services, how we implement our different youth services. That's the stage we're at now. We've already gotten the planning kind of out of the way. So that's, this is actually the best time for family, friends, everybody to be involved in the discussion so that we know which direction we want to go with it. We want to implement best practices, but we also want to implement ones that work. And we won't know that if everybody's in with it.
Do you have a designated time that you're meeting or is that yet to be determined?
We do. It's the third, I want to say the third Thursday. It's had to change a couple times, which is why I'd like anybody that's interested to take part or to write down my email as you come up here, because I can get you guys on the listserv so that you know the implementation dates. We actually just had one last week, so the next one won't be until the end of August.
And daytime, nighttime?
Daytime.
Daytime?
Yes.
What time?
Usually around 10, 11.
Okay.
We try to find what works for all the various service providers.
How many sit on your group right now?
Oh, we're at about a dozen here between various agencies such as the region, Capital Inn, Regional West, the school, ESU 13. We actually have a Kimball County Commissioner and Judge Warden has attended a meeting or two now. So we're just looking to diversify our platform right now.
Good. Any questions from council?
You can put that back up there. I took a picture of it. That way somebody else wants it, they've got it.
Yours.
Yeah. You'll be getting to meeting with them. That would there.
Any other questions from council? All right, thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, we'll go to 9B. Council received a presentation from the Panhandle Humane Society.
I'm the executive director of the Humane Society, and I'm sure you're all aware that it's Dogus, which is the universal birthday celebration for all shelter animals everywhere, because nobody knows their true birthday, so it's a pretty big deal for us. Anyways, it's just something fun that we do. As you can probably understand, it's kind of a hard place to be some days, so we try to make it fun as much as we can. I'm going to pass out our P&L and some really great reporting I found, which shows that how we rate amongst all the shelters in Nebraska as well as shelters across the United States. And kind of interesting that we all deal with just about the same thing everywhere. We're just coming out of cat season right now. Well, I shouldn't say we're coming out of it. We're knee deep in it, but July was a really rough month for us. We, on a typical day, we have about 120 cats. Wow. Right now, we have 6 dogs in adoption and 2 in impound, and the rest is cats everywhere. Cats everywhere, and so we have a real problem with feral cats in our community. So I would like to address that in the future with you all, with a TNR, which is a trap, neuter, release program. But for now, we're doing the best that we can with the domesticated cats that we have. We literally can't give them away, honestly. It costs us about $80 a cat to get them either spayed or neutered, microchipped, fully vaccinated. We even get give them free health visits with a vet. That's a pretty substantial amount of money that every cat's worth that because they need that. We certainly don't want to have them multiply repeatedly as they are. But so over the past weekend, we did $5 cats. So that was finally how we cleared out our cat situation. So the feral cats are a little bit tougher because they're not somebody that they're not typically cats that we want to spend a lot of money on unless they have somewhere to go. So that's kind of what a TNR program is. So again, I'll be talking to you more about that in the future. But dogs are going really well. We're getting them adopted out. We don't typically this time of year have a lot in impound. We do have some fundraisers coming up. We have the Vintage Motorcycle Show, which raises about $4,000 for us. This will be the fourth year. Up until now, that money has gone into our food fund, which we feed all our dogs, Science Diet, so that there's not a constant fluctuation in what they're eating, so they all stay pretty healthy. And but this year, we're going to put that money toward our new building. We're just now starting to talk about a new adoption facility, which would be adjacent to what we currently where we currently live, which would be between us and the Boy Scouts. We're in the really preliminary stages of this. Have some money in our account right now, in our foundation account, and we'll be doing some fundraising from there, which will be pretty substantial. But and so the current building that we have will kind of phase out eventually, but it'll become just our impound, because where we have impound animals now, it's okay, but it's not great. This building has been added onto again and again and again. The plumbing is awful and the ventilation is ridiculous. Tired of watching kids come up with their nose, you know, like this. It smells in here. It's like, yeah, well, it does smell in there. Dogs smell sometimes. So we're looking at a new adoption facility where we can have state-of-the-art ventilation and plumbing. It'll be a humble facility. We don't need anything super fancy, but we want it nice, really nice for the animals. So that's what we're looking for in the future, and that's what most of our fundraising will be geared toward. You'll be hearing a lot more about that in the coming year. It's going to take some time. We do have Paul Reed that's working with us on this. So we thank you for all your support from the city. We obviously couldn't do this without your funding. And that's all I really have, I guess. Anybody have any questions for me?
Questions. Scus Bluff gives, looking here, $45,717.42. Does that include the fees that we give back to you for the pickup fees? Like when we pick up a dog, there's a fee for picking that up.
Yes.
That's included in that.
And this is only October through September, which is our fiscal year is over the end of September. And so if you look at the pay, the shelter statistics, which is the second part of that. It's just kind of interesting to look at, well, obviously for me, but this is just the quarter, April through June, and you can see that our strays make up 66% of the animals that we get in there. The clinic, which is 20%, that's basically all the animals that come in that we license, or we have the pet health fair, that covers all those animals that don't belong to us. They're animals that people bring to the health fair to have microchipped or vaccinated. That's kind of consistent with the whole United States, which is 36% of any given facility is strays. Also, we try hard to keep our euthanasia rates down. We do transfer out a lot of animals that we just don't have room for, which right now isn't an issue with dogs, but we will get there really soon, here in a few months. Be bursting at the seams with dogs. So we do work well with other shelters, other rescues, Colorado, Wyoming, even Kansas. We just recently shipped a dog to Kansas. So we work with them so that we're never having to euthanize for space. So that's really important to us. We also have someone that, a dog trainer that works with us on behavioral issues. So we work hard to try and dogs that we have. But even then, there are some that we can't save. We are the eyes and the ears for all households here in Scotts Bluff and Gearing in the surrounding area, so we're not going to be able to let just any dog into a home. That's not very responsible of us. We take that very seriously, and so we do have some euthanasias because some dogs just can't be caged. So we do have transfers, like I said, at 4.9%, which is actually more than the state of Nebraska or the United States in our outcomes. So that shows that we really are trying to save as many animals as we can. Sadly, nobody wants cats. have some great fundraisers, and we have a wonderful community that supports us in so many ways. We're very fortunate. So things are always turning around every year. Looks better than the last.
Questions from council?
You said you would see a spike in the dogs that are impounded. Is that just because of the weather, or what causes that?
It's the weather. Things start to get cold, and people start to worry that maybe they can't take care of their animals. Sometimes it's through the brink of puppy season, which is, you know, more in the spring. But you know, cats, this time of year, cats are breeding like crazy. But we don't see cats ever completely fall off. But you know, in the winter months, it's not nearly as bad as it is. But dogs, you know, it's. I started in September, and it seemed like everywhere there were dogs, and I'm kind of expecting that, but it's dropped off a little bit since I've been there, and I can't really tell you why that is. We typically adopt them out pretty fast, too. Our length of stay is shorter than it used to be, so that's good news for us. It seems like our problem is always the cat, and I'm a cat lover, so that's unfortunate for me, so we're always working on ways to address that.
Other questions? Thanks, Kathy. Okay, we're going to go back up to 8A. Council to conduct a public hearing 6:05 p.m. to consider the Class 1 liquor license application, Boozy Brushes, LLC, 2419 Avenue Ice, Gus Bluff, Nebraska. And we'll officially open up the public hearing. Anybody that will be testifying tonight, would you raise your hand, please? Okay. You swear to tell the truth, whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so have you got it? And Cindy, what do we have for exhibits?
We have exhibit one, the application of Boozy Brushes LLC. Exhibit number two is the city council checklist. Number three is the written statement of police chief. Number four is the written statement of city clerk. And number five is the written statement of city planner.
Make a motion to enter into the record exhibits 1 through 5.
Second.
Call the roll.
Shaver?
Yes.
Gonzalez?
Yes.
Caldwell?
Yes.
Meininger?
Yes. All right, the floor is yours. Tell us about your organization and why you're looking for a liquor license.
Well, I'm Boozy Brushes is going to be my name, and I'm a paint and sip. It's a group guided paint lesson. And go in with your friends and drink wine and have snacks. But I'm also looking to do some kids parties and have private parties. And I'll give another place for the kids to come. But I'm from Colorado, and kind of the paint and sip industry has boomed in the last few years, so just hoping to bring a little bit of our community here to Scott's Bluff. There's a couple pop-up parties, so to say, every couple months you'll see them on Facebook or whatnot. So I wanted to have an official shop where you can come in. A lot of places right now are hosting at like bars or restaurants, so I kind of wanted to just have it in one place at one spot.
Okay, and you said you're having different parties and kids, so how do you manage the alcohol? How do you keep the alcohol from the minors?
Well, I'll card everyone at the door when they come in. You'll get a wristband if you are over 21. And then whoever's serving the alcohol, if they presume that you're underage, they can always re-card. The alcohol will be stored in a locked room, and I will be the only one with of two different colored cups to distinguish alcohol drinkers and non-alcohol drinkers.
And who
started this, first of all, I apologize for my tardiness. I attended another meeting with the commissioner tonight that was at 4:30 and had 6:30 on the brain. So I was sitting at my desk when someone from here was emailing the chief. So again, I apologize. And I delayed the meeting schedule, and I apologize to you too. The chief started this background investigation and review and found nothing that disqualifies Emily in that review. He had spoken with Emily briefly during her testimony at the advisory council meeting as well, and provided some input in the memorandum. I too met with Emily at the site last week and had her explain, because it's very much under renovation. But she showed me what she envisions doing to secure the alcohol. It appears very adequate and thought out. We spoke a little bit about the addition of some security equipment that could assist her as well. And as she stated to you, I think her application indicated 2 to 3 employees, and that's situational to the type of event she's hosting, and that she will require server training of the employees. The zero tolerance policy was expressed throughout. Also, the use of colored cups was mentioned as well to assist in identifying those who have the wristband being associated with an alcoholic beverage was another thing that she spoke of. Any questions?
Questions from council?
What kind of size are we looking at, party-wise? I mean,
30 is my max.
Okay, so you're not talking a really big group. Easy to manage smaller group. Okay. That was my guess, but.
All right. Is there anybody in the audience that would like to testify that was not sworn in?
Thanks, Brad.
Okay. Not. I'll officially close the public hearing. Okay. Any last comments from you, Emily?
No. Thank you.
Okay. Questions from council? Looking for a motion to send a recommendation to the Liquor Council.
Move to send a positive recommendation to the Liquor Council for Boozy Brushes.
I'll second it, but I'm not saying it.
Come on.
Call the roll.
Gonzalez?
Yes.
Caldwell?
Yes.
Meininger?
Yes.
Schaefer?
Yes.
And 8B, council to make a recommendation to Liquor Control Commission naming Emily, is it Pugmire?
Correct.
Okay. As the liquor license manager of Boozy Brushes. I did say it.
I see.
I'd make a motion to send a positive recommendation for Emily to be the manager.
I will second it again, but I'm not saying it.
Call the roll.
Caldwell?
Yes.
Meininger?
Yes.
Shaver?
Yes.
Gonzalez?
Yes.
All right. Thank you. Congratulations. Council received a presentation from Monument Prevention Coalition. Maybe we should have had you first. Welcome.
There is one more seat up here if somebody out there wants to sit down. And I don't know if there are any other seats. If there's a seat next to you, you might let the people in the back know. Thank you.
My money's on her, sorry.
Good evening. My name is Lynette Richards, and I'm the project coordinator for Monument Prevention Coalition. And first of all, I'd like to thank you for helping fund our organization for the last 4 years, and we look toward the future with a partnership with you. Our mission statement is to create a community consensus that clearly states that underage drinking and excessive alcohol use is illegal, unhealthy, and unacceptable. Robert Wood Johnson Foundation states that with alcohol use, with underage alcohol use, it is as a community problem that also has a community solution. As our coalition, we work together to find a solution to prevent and lower the underage drinking underage drinking accessibility, as well as consuming. Our coalition has several strategies. One of the strategies we work with is, in order to keep our community safe for our youth, is we do alcohol serving training, and what we do is we fill in the gaps with the State Patrol does one 4 times a year, and then we do 4 times to fill in the gaps, as well as if anyone needs training in between those times. Our target audience is alcohol servers and sellers, and that includes volunteers. Our goal is to have all of our communities work together to make it mandatory, especially on your SDL license, to have some type of server training. Our second strategy is post-secondary education. And with this, we partner with WNCC to conduct surveys with the student body there. We also do data collection. We're working toward health risk assessments on campus and education and awareness also on campus. Our third strategy is Human Performance Project. And this is a project that we have with our schools. And it's not only in Scottsbluff County, but we work as a panhandle. And with this project, we strengthen and enforce alcohol policies that are already there as it deals with underage drinking. We do education on lifestyle choices with special emphasis on chemical health. We work with the minority-based group to address the risk of that population. We facilitate